إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله خير النبي اجتباه بلال العالمين أرسله الله بدين الحق ليظهر على دين كله ولو كره الكافرون اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأزواجه وذريته وأصحابه والتابعين والتابعين بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد عباد الله أذكركم وإياي بتقوى الله سبحانه وتعالى أذكركم بقوله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن الكريم حيث يقول يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أذكركم وإياي بحفظ القرآن الكريم وسنة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the bounties that He bestows upon us. Alhamdulillah, one of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-Mannan, the bestower of gifts. Of the 99 beautiful names, one of the names that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described to Himself is al-Mannan, the bestower of gifts. Alhamdulillah, there is a hadith or a dua that the Prophet ﷺ heard one of the Sahaba mentioning. He said, Allahumma inni as'aluka walhamdulak la ilaha illa ant al-mannan nabi'u samawati wal-ard dhul jalali wal-ikram al-hayyu al-qayyum. The Prophet ﷺ heard one of the Sahaba mentioning this name, al-mannan, in the dua. And he said, the dua reads, O Allah, I ask you, affirming that all praise is yours, that there is no true God except you. You are al-Mannan, the bestower of gifts, the originator of the heavens and the earth, possessor of majesty and honor, the ever-living, the oft-sustaining, the self-sustaining. And he said that, the Prophet said that he has supplicated to Allah using his greatest name. When supplicated with this name, he answers, and when asked with this name, he gives. Al-Mannan. I was thinking about this gift, and I was thinking about the gift that this community was blessed with the visitation of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the last week or so. And alhamdulillah, to sit here and to have been the presence of a human being that is only separated from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by 38 people is an immense blessing for every single one of us. When we say Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala Sayyidina Muhammad, you are looking at a direct descendant with only 38 people between himself and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, this is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What I want to mention though, is the gift of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. And I was thinking about this, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being sent, He says, Huwa al-Ladhi, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ba'atha fi ummiyyin, that He sent amongst the unlettered, if you will. And al-Tabari and others say that this ummiyyin refers to the Arabs in his tafsir. He says, fi ummiyyin, rasulun minhum yatlu alayhim ayatika wa yuzakkihim. In the verse when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this reality, He says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He will send, that He is the one who is sent amongst the unlettered people, the Arabs, from amongst themselves, a messenger who will read them your signs, and He will purify them, and He will teach them the kitab wal hikmah. And that before that, that they were in clear error. That before that they were in clear error. Now the interesting thing is that, alhamdulillah, if we take time and we deliberate and we think about this and we look at these ayat, look at the two realities. It is he who was sent amongst the unlettered messengers among themselves, who will recite them their verses, purifying them of disbelief and polytheism, and teaching them the book and the hikmah, the sunnah. So now the order has changed. When Ibrahim alayhi salam makes a dua, he puts the tazkiyah, he puts the purification at the end. But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this verse, he pulls up the tazkiyah to be the second thing that happens after the verses, after the signs of Allah are read to them. This is amazing. Because now it shows you the maqsad, the reason of why the Prophet is being sent to us. The last 2 points, to teach us the kitab wa sunnah. That's the qasd of the Prophet. But how is that done? It's done by reciting the signs and then purifying. Reciting the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then purifying. So alhamdulillah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us in these verses that the foremost, before you can even begin on this path, you have to affirm within yourself the place of having a purified heart to have the kitab and the sunnah opened up for you. That's the message that is being conveyed here. And perhaps that is why we are seeing the tribulation that we are seeing right now, because that aspect of ihsan, that aspect of iman is being disregarded. We have youth that are growing up that know nothing about dhikr, that know nothing about reciting Quran together. And I know this because I spent this entire summer, next week being the last week, 4 of 8 weeks with your children. Dhikr, what is this? Why would we do that? Read Quran together, why would we do this? This is a reality. But yet, fortnight, and every other day that you want to talk about, front to back, every single thing can be mentioned, every single character, every single level, every single weapon, and so on. If we remove tazkiyah from our reality as Muslims, then be prepared, because this is only the beginning. This is only the beginning of what we'll see, of literally, as we say here, the wheels falling off of this. But if we can be people that will look back and take this advice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to heart and understand that it's a reality, not some offshoot of Islam, but a reality that is foundational in our tradition for the kitab and the sunnah to be opened up for ourselves. Now we may differ on the means of how we get there, but the reality that tazkiyah is a foundational aspect of our religion. Affirmed in these verses right here by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Made dua from the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, and then put to the forefront by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah. As we said, that we know that this verse, that we understand and we know the favor that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us, this favor of purification, and that we must begin here. Alhamdulillah. When we look at this idea of purification, think about that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator of every single heart. So that He knows what is required for that purification to happen. And then He sends the Prophet for this ummah and subsequent prophets for other ummahs. But let's look at this reality of our Prophet and the way that he was sent, the manner in which that tazkiyah happened, the manner in which he manifested that, and what the outcome is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, giving us multiple ways of how to bring that tazkiyah into our lives, to bring that purification of the heart into our lives, the purification of our eyes, of our ears, of our tongue, of our hearts, of our stomach, of our feet, of our wealth, of our intentions. It has an impact. And the impact, ya bushra, the impact is glad tidings to all of you who want to follow this. In the hadith of Tirmizi, the Prophet ﷺ mentions that there are 120 ranks, 120 rows in Jannah. 120 rows in Jannah. And 80 of those rows are of the Ummah of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that should show us that the means in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent for the Prophet to show us to be purified works. Because of all of the other Anbiya combined have 40 rows. And the Prophet has 80 rows of 120, so that should indicate to you that the method, the means in which we have been given to get into paradise is nothing short of an absolute blessing. That's why I began with the gift, the al-mannan, the gifts being bestowed upon us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This should be the reality in which we see all things now. My job is not some end in and of itself. It's a means to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My family is a means of the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My education is a means to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on and so on and so on. But unfortunately, too often I hear from people that are separating those realities. That my work is one thing, and my family is one thing, and my friends are one thing, and then there's this thing called Islam that I can put on and take off. It's not the Tazkiah that was taught to us by the best of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed every single one of us to have His tongue, to have our tongues mentioned, and to have Him in our heart, and have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our heart. That's not our reality. The reality is that that we are with Him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in this ummah. And this is the path that has been given to us, for us to follow. A path that has been set out from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not what our desires and our means, or what our desires and our needs may be, but what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set out for us. So alhamdulillah, most important we see that this understanding and understand this process of purification of the Prophet, as we said, is not from our own ideas and our own desires. Because if that was the case, it would be fragmented. And as I said, dividing our life into aspects. But rather, this is about submission and surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah give us tawfiq. If we look at this idea of teaching the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, first we have to understand that how do we see those signs? How do we see those signs? These signs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, فَلَمْ يُسْيِرُوا فِي الْعُبْ فَتَكُنْ لَهُمْ قُلُوبٍ يَعْقِلُونَ بِهَا أَوْ آذَانٍ يَسْمَعُونَ بِهَا فَإِنَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبِ أَلَتِي فِي صُدُورِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks a rhetorical question to us. What is that morsel that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned that if it is pure, the entire body is pure? What is the morsel in the body that Allah says will only enter paradise if it is upright? What is mentioned over and over and over again about being purified? And what is mentioned in this verse that it's not the eyes that go blind, as Allah says in the Quran? Do they not travel through the land so that their hearts and their minds may thus learn wisdom and that their ears may hear? Truly it is not their eyes that go blind, but it is their hearts within their breasts. We can look at the signs, we can look at the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over and over and over again. But if there is no tazkiyah, and this is filled with that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will see nothing from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will see nothing from the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I did not exclude myself in that statement. That's the reality of tazkiyah. It is not some periphery that maybe we go to if we make that decision at some point in our life. It is the lifeline in the time that we are in now. It has been the lifeline of this ummah at the time of tribulation. More so now than ever. More so now than ever. And if we're asking ourselves this question, then we should check our hearts.
Because the answer is apparent and clear. The answer is apparent and clear of what the solution is. May Allah make us people of Tazkiah. May Allah make us people of Tazkiah. Quickly here, I'll just read some of these ayat in English. We don't have time for the Arabic. And so the Nahl, Allah talks about this, talking about the signs. It is He who sends down water from the sky. From it you drink from it, and your shrubs come in, and you graze your herds on it. And by it He makes crops grow for you, olive, dates, and grapes, and fruits of every kind. Therein is certainly a sign for people who reflect. So Allah puts this first category when He tells you about these signs. The first thing is that there has to be يَتَفَكِّرُونَ Allah said, يَتَفَكِّرُونَ those that reflect. And then the next one He says, He has made the night and the day subservient to you, the sun and the moon and the stars also. If you have not done it, then go on and sight the moon. The community is preparing for Hajj. Prepare yourself to be more connected with the ghaib, with the unseen, by going out on the first of Dhul Hijjah on that night and looking for the moon. And you will see this phenomenon that happens every single month. But if our eyes are, if our heart is blind, then our eyes will not see it. Every month that moon comes from a state, from a moment when it is unseen into the realm of the seen. And the beautiful thing is that the same thing and the same word that is used for birth. We have it. This child coming from the world of the unseen into the realm of the seen. From the angelic realm into this realm. So Allah mentioned that. People who reflect. People who use their intellect. People who are mindful. And then after He says those things, so after reflecting, after being mindful, and after using your intellect, He says that there's two things in this series. It's Ayahs 10 through 17. I say, please go and read them after this. Ayahs 10 through 17 of the 16th chapter of the Quran. And then the last thing, two things He says, so that you will give thanks. So He's doing all of this and telling you all of this so that you will be people of shukr. And then when you are people of shukr, what will happen? That you will be people who are guided. And you'll be people who are guided. May Allah guide us all. May Allah guide us all. أَحَمَّ لِهَذَا صَفِّ لَكُمْ سَلْوَكُمْ إِيَّكُمْ بِصَفِّ اللَّهِ إِنَّهُ هُوَ غُفُورُ رَحِيمٌ. إن الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا كما أمر وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا سيدنا محمد عبده ورسوله عباد الله أذكركم بقوله سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم حيث يقول في الحديث اتقوا الله حيثما كنتم وذكركم بشرف مكان مصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم حيث يقول الله في القرآن الكريم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد كما صليت وباركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. الحمد لله. There is more that I'd like to say, but alhamdulillah, Allah is the one who distributes. So whatever we have received is from the hikmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But just in closing, I want to say here that, again, as we move into the season of Hajj, that we think of it as a means of purification, whether we are on the Hajj or not on the Hajj, because perhaps with a purified heart, we will make an intention to be on the Hajj, and we will find written with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that in 2018, while you are here, that you will have a Hajj written for you because you had a pure heart. May Allah make us of those people. Ameen. So alhamdulillah, just in closing, as I said, and as this month approaches us, the season approaches us of the Hajj, that understand that this is a time, alhamdulillah, to really think about purification and the ultimate purification for when we cross over and leave this world, because that is the reality of the Hajj. And that's what we should be thinking about during these days and these nights which we are approaching, which are the best 10 for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be worshipped in. So alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us taysir. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open up for us, alhamdulillah, an immense opening.
Alhamdulillah, just in closing, I just want to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that when this example of Tazkiah, to show you this, that when Musa is sent to Fir'aun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, اِذْهَبْ إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ إِنْهُ تَغَارَ قُلْ هَلْ لَكِ إِلَىٰ أَنْ تَزَكَّى. Right? He tells him that, go to Pharaoh, for verily, he is a transgressor. And what is the antidote? What is it that he gives him? What is it that he offers him? What does Allah want from Fir'aun? He wants him to have a purified heart. Say to him, will you not purify yourself? That's the command of Musa. That's the command of Musa to Fir'aun from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the question that I should be asking myself every day. Will you not purify yourself? And we work in that rhetorical cycle, and we work in that cycle, constantly trying to better ourselves, constantly trying to better ourselves. Bi-idhnillah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will die in that state, and outcomes are not with us. Outcomes are with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have our intentions, and then inshallah ta'ala, we live on those intentions, and die on those intentions, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise us up from people who have purified hearts, and those who come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَا مَنْ لَا يَفْعَلْنَا وَلَا يَوَلُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهِ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. That we will come to the people on Yawm al-Qiyamah being raised up with those who knew that no wealth and no progeny could benefit them except for the ones who came to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with an upright heart. اللهم ارحم المؤمنين والمؤمنات المسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم افتح علينا فتحا قريبا مبينا وسع الفتح إليك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى عن الناس يا رب العالمين. ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. ربنا إننا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذريتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم ارحمنا فوق الأرض وتحت الأرض يوم نقوم بين يديك رب العالمين. اللهم أكرمنا بالقرآن، اللهم أكرمنا بالقرآن، اللهم أكرمنا بالقرآن. اللهم اجعلنا من أهل القرآن، اللهم اجعلنا من أهل القرآن، اللهم اجعلنا من أهل القرآن. اللهم اجعل القرآن ربيع قلوبنا وشفاء صدورنا ونور في قبورنا يا رب العالمين. وصلى اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. أقيم الصلاة والحمد لله رب العالمين.